right, we're gonna switch a little, switch over from hardware to software. Yeah. So John and I and all of the folks here at the University of Washington are working on the software and algorithms that will be used to make this project a success. That's in addition to teams in Stanford, in Princeton, at the National Supercomputing Center in Illinois, and in Tucson. So we have a particular bias towards the software things. And because here at the University of Washington, we're focused on detecting the things that change in the sky, I'm gonna focus on how we're gonna actually do that. But first, let's start out by just talking about how LSST, as we said before, is a different kind of telescope. The telescope itself is not the actual product that we're working towards. What we're working towards is making a database with petabytes of images and catalog and data, databases with trillions of entries that will provide sort of a Google index of the entire night sky over the course of 10 years. So to do that, as we mentioned before, we're going to need a large computing resources. And in addition, we're actually building our own high-speed network to connect the telescope in Chile to the supercomputing center in Illinois, with redundant networks in case one of them goes down due to an earthquake or something like that. So in LSST, we break up the software into three groups that we're gonna be providing to all of you. First of all, every night we're going to be detecting nearly 10 million different things that explode or move or burst or flare in the night sky. We're gonna send those out in nightly alerts that anybody can subscribe to if they have their favorite constellation or star or something like that. Also, every year we're gonna provide a deep, very deep static map of the sky, kind of like a Google Maps that'll allow you to navigate the entire sky, as well as catalogs that map the locations of all of the objects that we're gonna find. And finally, we're gonna provide essentially cloud computing services that will allow people to upload their algorithms or their software into the computing cluster that we provide, so that they can do their custom computations, maybe something that we haven't thought of to do on the data, but do it right at the data rather than having to download petabytes of data to their own laptop and do it there. So, in some ways, I messed that up. So we're basically providing the equivalent of astronomical Twitter, Google, and Amazon Web Services to the community. So as I said before, I'm gonna focus on how we're going to detect all of the things that change throughout the night. Here's an example. This is an example supernova. This guy right here is a star that's exploding in this distant galaxy. And this guy is actually pretty easy to find. But it turns out it's going to be a lot harder. I'm going to kind of step you through the scale of the problem as we're going to be trying to figure it out. So here again is a picture of the detector, the LSST detector, that has 189 separate CCD detectors, as we all know now. Here's one of those detectors that I've highlighted. And so each of those detectors is going to provide a map of the sky similar to this. 16 million pixels that's going to have a deep image of thousands of galaxies and stars. And so now let's say, for example, We want to see if there's a certain if there's a supernova going off in one of these galaxies in one of these images. How do we do that? So let's zoom in. Does anyone have any idea where that supernova is? On the right. So I'm giving away a little secret here. This is the way astronomers detect supernovae. We look for the yellow arrow. So actually what we do is we need to look at an image that was taken weeks or months before or after the time of the supernova. And so here's two images that show the same area of the sky with that same little splotch that's a galaxy, and you can see that the supernova is not there in the leftmost image. The way we actually do the comparison is we need to first take the two images and align them. We need to make sure that because the atmosphere could be different between the two different images, we need to make sure that we can match up the blurriness of the two images and so on. And this is a very precise process. Once we can do that, all we need to do is simply subtract the two images. And in the image subtraction over there, the supernova appears pretty easily. The hard part of this project is that in each image we expect to find on the order of tens of thousands of objects, not supernovae only, but asteroids and variable stars and so on. And so one question is how we're going to prevent detecting things that aren't actually real objects, because there's going to be artifacts in the images and there's going to be issues that we're going to have to deal with. And so that's actually the main thing that we're going to be working on over the next 2 years, is trying to hammer this out and cut down so that we don't want to send out false objects to everybody. So now I'm going to talk about asteroids. So here, this animation shows an animation of asteroids in the asteroid belt as they would appear in the southern sky during the course of a year. You can see, I don't know if you guys can see, there's some yellow guys moving very quickly across the sky. Those are actually asteroids that come closer to Earth, and because they come closer to Earth, they appear to be moving faster. So how are we going to detect these asteroids? Actually, here's another image. This is provided by someone who's here in the audience right now, who took some images that were taken from out beyond Pluto, and you can see two asteroids that probably have orbits out beyond Neptune moving across these frames over the course of a few hours. So this is a different problem from looking for supernovae. Although we're gonna use the same kind of procedure that I described before. We're gonna use that image subtraction procedure. But what we're gonna look for is, in the case of asteroids that move really fast, they're gonna look more like blurs. And so we'll be able to look for those and identify whether those are asteroids or stars or supernovae or whatever. For asteroids that move more slowly, we might not be able to detect those elongated blobs. And so what we're going to have to do is we're going to have to take images, multiple images each night, and then over the course of a few nights, and then connect those tracks, like I show on the bottom here. Those tracks, if you can connect those into a track, then that suggests that that's probably an asteroid. And in fact, if you can do that over a number of days, shown in this kind of simulation here, we should actually be able to tie these down to their actual orbits and identify if these fall in the asteroid belt or out beyond Neptune. Now this orbit calculation is a really computationally intensive process, and so we're not going to be able to do it each night as we're taking the images. We're going to have to pre-compute these during the day, store those, and then look them up during the night. So once we've detected these millions of objects every night, we need to send them out to the public. So we're going to set up an alert system where we're going to be sending out each object, cross-reference it with all of the other objects that have been detected. So if it's an asteroid, cross-reference it with other times that it's been detected as an asteroid. We're going to send out other previous measurements so that we can tell if it's a variable star or a supernova. We're going to send out these cutout images so that individuals will be able to look at them and say, hey, that's near a galaxy, that's probably a supernova. Each of these alerts is going to be about 60 kilobytes, but because we're going to be sending about 10 million of these every night, we're basically going to be sending out nearly 600 gigabytes worth of simply just these alerts every night. And so basically, if one of you are going to want to, you know, subscribe to these, you're going to max out your Comcast allocation, your monthly allocation in one night. So, what we like to joke about is that subscribing to all of these alerts would be akin to basically drinking from a fire hose. And so, obviously, you don't want to do that. So what we're going to do, actually, instead, is send these alerts to institutions that are pre-subscribed, that have written algorithms, like machine learning algorithms, as someone already asked, to filter and classify these alerts. And so if anyone wants to, anybody in the public, any classroom teacher or anybody can subscribe, they'll want to subscribe to one of these brokers, and these brokers will be able to tell them when something cool is happening. So finally, there's also a significant amount of effort going into writing software that's going to be devoted to public outreach. And so this includes, for example, an iPhone app that people can use to subscribe to their favorite asteroid or something like that. And we're really expecting that primary school educators, college students, will be able to use these data, will be able to subscribe to different services and use these services to learn about the universe and do their own citizen science. So that's the end of that part of the talk, and here's a bunch of sites you can look up for more information. And I guess now's the time to take some questions. Questions? That's a good question. So the question is, that slide that showed the asteroid looping, maybe I can even go back to it. How does that work? That's a combination of the effect of both the asteroid moving through space and the fact that the Earth is moving through space. And so because the Earth moves through space, you get this parallax effect where it appears like the asteroid is moving relative to the stars in the background. And so over the course of a year, you get these loops. Question? Okay, that's a good one. So the question is, related to the blurriness of the images, is there any adaptive optics or anything like that happening, being used here to account for the blurriness? Because stars in the atmosphere, stars twinkle as they come through the atmosphere, that leads to them being blurry when we image them on the detector. There's not going to be any adaptive optics as we typically think about them, but the site itself has been mapped out and is really significant, really pristine. We're going to get very high resolution images just due to that, but we'll still have variation due to different weather patterns moving throughout.
There's going to be some use of the wavefront sensors to do some adaptive optics.
That's true. There is going to be use of what's called wavefront sensors that are those. Let's see if I can show you here. There are going to be sensors on the edges of the detectors that will be able to sense whether the atmosphere is changing rapidly across the detector.
Okay.
I think the question is related to this project is going to take place over 10 years. And so how are we going to actually utilize technology that's going to advance over the course of those 10 years? And so that is an excellent question. And actually, the computational resources that we're going to need to do these analyses are projected to be the computational resources that we're going to have at the beginning of the survey. But we don't anticipate that we're going to improve or advance those algorithms to follow the computational resources during the course of the survey. We want the survey to be as consistent as possible throughout the entire 10-year. Going to detect dark matter? That is an excellent question because it leads right into the next talk. So I'm going to save the answer to that question for the next talk. The question is, how are we going to share this information with the public? Oops. I guess I did not go into that in enough detail. There we go, thank you. But essentially, LSST itself is not going to be responsible for writing interfaces that help share the data with the public. People, citizen scientists, for example, who are interested and have enough knowledge to access the website, they can actually do queries on, they'll be actually able to do queries on the databases themselves, similar to what's been done with a previous survey. But essentially, for example, we have their websites such as Zooniverse, where people have used, people have classified galaxies from other surveys, and so we expect that there's going to be websites that are going to come up through institutions that are going to be able to provide those services. All right, thank you.